reminding us of the sweetness of the Holy Spirit. Thank our kind lockers. The little Quaid, thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Nice to be here this morning. The Lord is good. So we have young Dick with us this morning. New shoulders. Strong this morning. Yeah. Have Gordon with us. Oh, what a good day. What a blessed day. Please follow with me in our bulletin. In our call to worship. Call upon the Lord, for God hears our pleas.
Cry a river of tears to wash away my sorrow.
Put your faith in God, our great physician.
Reach out for the balm of Gilead, for thou hearest the cries of the suffering.
The Lord delivers the faithful to the glory of God's name.
We call upon the Lord, for God hears our pleas.
Enter
God's gates with hope and gladness.
Let us repeat our opening prayer together.
Righteous God, let your compassion come speedily to lead us. For we are brought low in our need. Our spirits are poured out by thorny waters, and there is no one to pity us in our pain. Can you not hear the scoffers say, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Help us, O God, our salvation, for the glory of your great name. Let your compassion come speedily to us once more, that all may see and know where the true God lies. Amen.
Please continue to let worship God as we sing our opening hymn. Number 371, I stand amazed in the presence.
Thank you.
already I can see a number of joys around. Are there any joys you want to share with us? Cares or concerns?
Well, Rusty came to save the day on the farm. So he remembers how to drive a tractor, but when he drove one, he didn't have Sirius XM radio. Well, you don't So he's helping us. Rick and Danette are on the way again to Mayo's this morning. And so good things are going to happen. Thank you for your prayers. All of you.
I'm going to pray for her. I'm going to pray that this evil that's in her finger would leave, go to out of darkness, and she'd come back to her blood.
Yes.
And put her in the hands of Jesus Christ. He will take care. We ask the doctors to take one more look. I wanted to just mention a couple of things. One, we have Taking It to the Streets, which is a training on disciple making and outreach, this Saturday, September 28th at Halstead. I lived just half a block from here for a while I was pastoring the church there. So it's Saturday, September 28th at 10 a.m., Halstead United Methodist Church. Also wanted to invite folks to join the crop walk. Those who'd like to walk five, you don't have to walk all 5 miles. They have cars going back and forth. And anytime you've had enough, the car picks you up. So some of us are stubborn. Some of us do walk the 5 miles. But we like sponsors. And remember this, that when you give to the crop walk, a lot of it comes right back here. I'm not sure what percentage, but it comes right back to where it came from, right here. And there is a food bank at First United, St. John. A lot of money comes to stock there. So it's not only we're giving it to those folks over there, we're giving it to our folks here as well. Any of the joys, concerns?
Thank God for the wonderful weather.
Exactly. Gordon, what do you
say? Mike will be here. Yeah, Mike will see everybody.
And we're happy to see you. And for that. Dick, you wanted to say anything?
Sure.
Sounds like
I had my good shoulder replaced a week ago Friday. I'm supposed to be in my sling. My wife keeps reminding me of that, but I feel better without it. And I think I'm doing real well. So
the Lord is good.
Praise God.
And to think he gave our surgeons all of that knowledge and wisdom, acumen, to be able to do that. Okay, we're going to now hear from our youth.
Jason.
Thank you.
blessing to be here at Antrim. All the men are handsome. All the women are beautiful, and all the children are talented. Are there any other joys, cares, concerns you want to share? Let us now continue with our worship as we go to God in prayer. Loving God, you are our heart's desire. We praise you and exalt you and wish most of all to please you, worship you, to serve you. May our prayers rising reflect our love for you and our commitment to each other. May our relationships with each other reflect a dedication to your concern for all people. May our care for your world reflect your desire to restore all of creation. May our willingness to serve reflect your willingness to give your life for the sake of your people. As we all pray in silence, grant the courage, the healing, the hope that each of us needs. Oh God, please help all Christians to not trust in our own works and in our own accounts and in our own efforts, but to trust in Jesus Christ alone for our salvation, for our eternal life. Please, Lord, forgive us for refusing to accept your free gift of salvation. Help us to realize that your grace is sufficient. Father, this morning we bring so many of our people before you. And there are others we probably wouldn't name, but they're there, and we ask your blessings and your Holy Spirit right now that we would break through the net as they leave and go to Colorado once again. We ask, Lord, that you bless Gordon and Danetta and give them a reasonable portion of health and strength. Thank you, Lord, for the successful operation on Dick's shoulder. And we ask, Lord, you bring him back to full health and strength, and even more of him and vigor and vitality. Father, you ask a blessing on each and every one of us this morning. Be with us. Strengthen us. Use us in your service. We ask you bless our president and the cabinet and all those in charge of the services, the armed forces, all those in authority over us. We pray, Lord, that they would make godly decisions. We pray for all leaders this morning. Pray, Lord, that they would take evil away from them and replace evil with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy on our community. Have mercy on all communities this morning. We ask, Father, that you would rid us of hatred, all hatred, right up throughout society, Lord, throughout the world. Help us to seek love. Help us to love. Help us to be children of the God of love. Now, these are now the blessings we ask in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who calls
us our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We're going to ask Mary once again to lead us in our hymn, Nothing Between You, number 373. Number 373. Thank you. invite you to turn with me this morning in your Bibles. We're going to be in the New Testament this morning, which is the back of the pew Bibles. We're going to read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, 1 through 13. It's page 77 of the pew Bibles of the back. Page 77. Luke. Chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. Listen to the word of God. Jesus also said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a steward, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his goods. And he called the steward and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward.' The steward said to himself, 'What shall I do, since my master is taking the stewardship away from me? I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so the people may receive me into their houses when I am put out of the stewardship.' So some of his master's debtors, one by one, he said to the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He said, 100 measures of oil. And he said to him, 'Take your bill and sit down quickly to write it.' Then he said to another, 'How much do you owe?' He said, 100 measures of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and write 80. The master commended the dishonest steward for his shrewdness. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous men, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal habitation. He who is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much. And he who is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he or she will hate the one and love the other, or he or she will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." Please turn with me to 1 Timothy, 1 Timothy, which is on page 198 at the back of the pew Bible. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 8, page 198 of the pew Bible. First of all, or above all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high position, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life, godly and respectful in every way. This is good, and it is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of this truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony to which was born at the proper time. For this I was appointed a preacher and apostle, and telling the truth I am not lying, a preacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. I desire then that in every place the people should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarrel. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Mostly from that second chapter of 1 Timothy, living on the wings of prayer. Living on the wings of prayer. Have you ever wondered for what you should pray? never been puzzled about that. Or even how should you pray? Sometimes, what is the best place for me to pray? Or where should I pray? Or what is acceptable prayer to our loving God? What does God look for in our prayers? Will God be listening to my prayers? I mean, I've been praying for something for years and it hasn't. Is God hearing me? Is God listening to me? Or will God give me the desires of my heart? I'm glad you asked because Psalm 37:4 says, take delight in the Lord. Now listen to this. Take delight in the Lord. Trust in Him. And He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in Him. And He, that is God, will act. And everyone remembers, God will give you the desires of your heart. But it comes with some prerequisites, some things that you must do before. Take delight in the Lord. Trust in Him. He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. You must do these things. Trust in Him, and God will act. God acts when you come to God with a clean heart, pure intentions, pure motives, and for the welfare of God and of God. In our passage, 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 8, it highlights two control themes on prayer and the inclusive nature of salvation. Now, many of us are going to be shocked when we get to heaven and we look around and we're going to say, wow, you are here too. You know, if we're rich, we're of the opinion that heaven is reserved for the rich. And there's a rich heaven over here. And when we get there, you know, many of us who are rich, including me, but we look to, wow, there's the poor. There are the other folks. There are folks that I thought would never make it. Paul believes that prayer is of the utmost importance in our lives. Prayer is of the utmost importance in our church. Nothing should happen without prayer. Paul is the greatest Christian who ever lived, and he established many churches around the world. He went around opening up churches and he'd preach here for a while and somebody would be keen and he'd say, okay, I'll make you the pastor and I'll teach you this, the word and I'll take care of you and I'll leave after a while. Now, once you've got it, now, once you know how to preach and share the word of God, I'm going to go on to the next town and set up another church. And while he was doing this, he met a young man by the name of Timothy. Now, you've got to understand, Timothy was one of the first, second generation Christians in the Bible. This young man, he was just a kid. And Paul set him up as pastor of the church of Ephesus. Now, as it turns out, his mother and his grandmother, Eunice, Lois were Jews, but they were first converts. You know, they were converted to Christianity. And his mother married a Greek guy, and he had this son by the name of Timothy in Ephesus, which of course you know is in Greece. And Paul was counseling and encouraging this young man to be the pastor of the church of Ephesus. So Paul sent this letter to Timothy and to the church and to you and to me. It's amazing. Paul was just writing to Timothy not knowing his words would be there forever. And his words that were appropriate for Timothy were appropriate for you and for me. And Paul knew that everything begins and ends in prayer. My friends, when you get up in the morning, if you're strong enough to get on your knees, not all of us are, just get on your knees. If you're young, and you can do it. Thank God. If you can't, just lie there in bed or sit on the side of the bed. Thank God for giving you a good night, allowing you to see this day, the beginning of this day. When you're ready to go to bed at night, thank God for giving you a good day. I know things might not have gone well, you know. Something might have busted on the tractor, or, you know, the car may have dropped, or the water heater may have gone. Well, thank God that you're still here and you're well. So Paul wants everything to begin with prayer. When I get in the car in the morning and I turn it on, I thank God for starting the car. There are times we didn't. I thank God for starting the car. I thank God for allowing me to be here. Thank God for the job. Get on the job, you thank God for that. Thank God when the job is over and you're going home. Just continually bathe yourself in prayer. 1 Timothy 2:1 says, first of all or above all. First of all or above all, I admonish and urge, I encourage, I urge, admonish and urge the petitions, prayers, intercessions. All these are different types of prayer. Petition, prayer, intercession, thanksgiving be offered on behalf of some people. No, he didn't say that. He said all these prayers be offered on behalf of all, A-L-L, all people. Not some people. Some people wish the worst for other people. And the best for themselves, well, it doesn't work for them. Paul says we pray for all human beings. 1 Timothy, 2nd chapter, verse 2, we pray for kings. They didn't have presidents in those days, but we pray for kings. We pray for presidents and all who are in positions of authority or high responsibility. This is verse 2 now. That outwardly we may pass a quiet and undisturbed life, and inwardly a peaceable one in all godliness and reverence and seriousness in every way. Well, some of us pray for our president. Some of us pray for presidents that our president would accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, would rule the country. Not only our president, but all presidents. Imagine if we had a president who so hated his own people that he dropped chemical weapons on his own people. Killing his own people. People of his own religion. People that are like him, his own country. He is destroying, killing people with the most lethal weapons known to humankind. But we must pray for that president. We must pray that he would come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And he would be able to see that it is a good thing to pray for and to bless and to do the best you can for the people God has put him in charge of as the president and leader. Paul's desire, again 1 Timothy 2:8, is I desire that in every place people should pray without anger or quarreling, or resentment, or doubt in their minds, lifting holy hands. Now, I know we're a mainline denomination, and every so often Dorothy lifts her hands and sort of people look. And I know, you know, the other denominations, if you're Catholic or Presbyterian or Methodist, you can't lift holy hands to God, but it's in the Bible. And you know, when I leave, you're going to say, you know, when Irving was here, he made people hold hands and put hands on others, lay hands on others, and then he made people, he encouraged people to lift holy hands to God. But I'm going to let you know, all of that is in the Bible. God uses our hands. And God wants us to use our hands. We lift our hands, our holy hands to God, seeking God's mercy and God's grace, that He would put His blessings into our hands. And then these hands that we have, we put them on someone's shoulders as we pray for them. It says, bless those in need of prayer. Put your hands, lay holy hands on them. And God invites us to take all, not some of our concerns to God. When we do find the act of prayer, when we do get into the mode of prayer, when we get into the attitude of prayer, when we understand that prayer is essential, when we understand that prayer is above all, prayer is first of all, the amazing thing happens. We receive some benefits. How amazing! We're praying for others and we receive benefits. Now, prayer benefits society. Prayer benefits society. For some of us, praying for people in governmental positions, kings, presidents, and all those in authority is so hard. So hard. So difficult for some of us to pray for the president of our country. But what if people spent more time in prayer and less time in attacking? You know, all over, as I traveled all over England, and I see pictures of the President of the United States in homes. I don't even have one in my home. I don't see any other homes with a picture of the President of the United States. And I've traveled all over England and I've seen pictures of the President of the United States. What would happen if we spent more time praying for our leaders and less time attacking our leaders? Wow, would our communities and nation be different? There is a time and a place to hold elected officials accountable, but there's also a time to hold them up in prayer. For the well-being of the nation. And we belong to the well-being of, we belong to the nation. For the well-being of the nation covers us. A leader can only do as well if the Christians who pray to the true and living God, if the Christians are praying for the leader and the official authority over us. So prayer benefits society, then prayer benefits individuals. And all of this comes right out of 1 Timothy. Prayer not only benefits society, prayer benefits us. When we pray, the most help comes to us. Paul said, 1 Timothy 2, when we pray, we, not they, not them, not somebody else, we live peaceful. You know, we have peaceful minds, quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. You know, God is on the side of the oppressed. We want to pray for those who are oppressed to be on the side with God. Prayer centers our minds and focuses on what is most important.
all boats. I'm amazed that people who are at the top of the pyramid tried to smash those on the bottom. They care not for those who need help. They care not for those who are sick. They care not for those who've been despised, those who've been thrown out of society. When you're on the top of the pyramid, if you do not pray and you want to destroy the bottom, the whole pyramid goes down. When you pray for those in need, at the base of the pyramid, the whole pyramid goes up. Now, if you're on the top, you will still stay on the top whether the pyramid goes down or it goes up. But how much better off we will all be if those of us at the top would pray for those of us at the bottom. We pray for the best for all. And prayer allows all of the pyramid to rise. Prayer allows all of the boats, your boat, my boat, everyone's boat, to rise. Prayer helps us individually by showing us what peace and godliness is like. 1 Timothy 2, verse 2 says, outwardly we may pass a quiet and undisturbed life, and inwardly a peaceable one in all godliness and reverence and seriousness in every way. Now, blame Paul, don't blame me. Don't point fingers at me. I'm just reading exactly what Paul said 2,000 years ago. So, go to Paul. Don't blame me for what I'm saying. I'm just reading exactly what he said. Outwardly we may pass a quiet and undisturbed life. Inwardly, a peaceable one in all godliness and revenue and seriousness in every way. Now, prayer benefits the church. Prayer benefits the church. Prayer benefits society. Prayer benefits us individually. And prayer benefits the church of Jesus Christ. In the church, we help people to understand the gospel, and it helps us. Prayer helps us to bring others into the church. Prayer helps us to bring others into a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. There's no one we want to go to hell. No one. It is a terrible place for all of eternity. No matter how bad a person is to us, no matter what a person has done to us, no matter which party the guy belongs to, we don't want him or her in hell. 1 Timothy 2:4 says, God our Savior, and I'm quoting the Bible now, 2,000 years ago, God our Savior wishes all men, well, it said all men, I would say all people, to be saved and increasingly to perceive and recognize and discern and know precisely and correctly the divine truth. If you get to praying, people will know the truth, and the truth will set people free. What is this divine truth that Timothy is talking about? Well, Paul to Timothy. Well, 1 Timothy 2:5. For there is, here's the divine truth, and we just read it. For there is only one God, and only one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, that's for all people, a fact that was attested to at the right and proper time. Jesus Christ came in the fullness of time, at the right time. God sent Jesus Christ here at the right time. And Paul reminds us that this is a fact that was attested to at the right and proper time. My friends, Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ wants us to pray. And Thomas said about Jesus Christ and to Jesus Christ, my Lord and my God. Do you recognize Jesus Christ today as your Lord and your God? Thomas did. That's 2,000 years ago. Surely 2,000 years later, we can recognize what Thomas did at that time, recognize Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. God Almighty, in the flesh. Even in that, I sure hope that everyone here believes that. And if you believe that, you will be saved. My friends, I urge and encourage you like Paul to Timothy. I urge and encourage you to live on the wings of prayer. Above all, first of all, let us get into a prayer mode. Let us learn to pray. Let us learn to do all the things that it says in 1 Timothy 2. Let us learn that God wants us to be prayer warriors. Let us be prayer warriors. And know this, that a rising tide lifts all boats. Let us pray for everyone. Let us pray for the whole world. Let us pray for society. Let us pray for individuals. Let us pray for our church. My friends, I encourage you to live on the wing. Let us now repeat our affirmation of faith, number 881. Those of us who can't stand, we encourage you to do that. 881. Yes. Apostles' Creed. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead, He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
service. I'm starting to meet him at 4:30. Old Max better let me walk with you.
Give you peace now and forever, all of God's children's have.
Amen. Amen.